Grace and Mercy Ministries presents This Is Your Season with Pastor Donald L. Watson. And now for today's message.
See, just because we have been saved by Christ does not mean Christians do not struggle with sin. In fact, reality is we find ourselves in a superior standard of life. Our spirit has been set apart by God, but our mind continue to have the patterns of the old thinking. And because our mind still has that pattern of the old thinking, we end up finding ourselves having an emotional battle in our mind. That emotional battle in our mind, that pattern just keeps popping up in us. So this morning, I want to take a look at Romans chapter 7. I'm reading from the New Living Translation. The topic this morning is the fight with the flesh. The fight with the flesh. Coming from the Living Bible, the New Living Translation. Chapter number 7. And this is an old familiar story or passage. We have read this several times. But hopefully reading it in the Living will give you a little more of an understanding. Starting in that 14th verse, it says, "The law is good then, and the trouble is not there, but with me, because I am sold into slavery with sin as my owner." Right there, he's already talking about how he is sold into sin. And the sin is his owner. He's sold into slavery, and sin is his owner. Verse 15, "I don't understand myself at all, for I really want to do what is right, but I can't. I do what I don't want to do, what I hate. I know perfectly well that what I'm doing is wrong. And my bad conscience proves that I agree with these laws I am breaking. But I can't help myself because I am no longer doing it. It is sin inside of me that is stronger than I am, that makes me do these evil things. I know I am rotten through and through, so far as my old sin nature is concerned. No matter which way I turn, I can't make myself do right. I want to, but I can't. When I want to do good, I don't. And when I try not to do wrong, I do it anyway. Now, if I'm doing what I don't want to do, it is plain where the trouble is. That is plain where the trouble is. Sin still has me in its evil grasp. It seems to be a fact of life that when I want to do what is right, I'm able to do what is wrong. I love to do God's will so far as my new nature is concerned. But there is something else deep within me, in my lower nature, that is at war with my mind and wins the fight and makes me a slave to sin that is still within me. In my mind, I want to be God's willing servant, but instead I find myself enslaved to sin. So you see how it is. My new life tells me to do right, but the old nature is still inside of me, loves to sin. Oh, what a terrible predicament I'm in. Who will free me from my slavery to the deadly lower nature? Thank God it has been done by Jesus Christ, our Lord. He has set me free. When we begin to look into this, 98% of this scripture, Paul is describing a struggle with sin. And as he's describing it with sin, it could be depressing. But we really need to be encouraged. Because if we're being encouraged, because Paul is one who wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. Paul is one who wrote 13 books of the New Testament. And Paul is letting you know that he's being transparent. That even though I got saved, even though I'm working for Christ, I still struggle. There's still a struggle in me. And because there's a struggle in me, I need to let you know that there's a struggle. See, because sometimes we begin to read the scriptures and we think everybody in the Bible is perfect. We think life just goes on so perfectly for them. But Paul wanted you to see something. This isn't about religion. This is about a relationship. This is about how you got to come before God. And here I am standing before him, want to do good. But for some reason, I just can't. And every time I go to do good, I end up back in those old sinful ways. So Paul wanted us to understand that even he went through it. He left 2% of the scripture, and when he left 2%, he left it so to teach us how to overcome sin tendencies in our life. And we have to understand that we have a struggle with all this body, which is called flesh. We have this struggle with this flesh, and as long as we're here on this earth, all of us have flesh on us. And Lord knows, if you don't have no flesh, please don't come around me. Because I don't want to see anybody without no flesh talking at that. You know, but we all have flesh, and this flesh has a sinful nature. And because it has a sinful nature, it is hard to control it. It is hard to put this flesh in check. It is hard to say, hey, stop it. Because it goes back to our old patterns. It goes back to the things that we're used to doing. It goes back into those things that you know, I said to somebody, I said, you know what, if you are a beggar in the world, you know, a hustle in the world, you'll come in God's house and still have a hustling spirit. See, because that hustling spirit doesn't necessarily leave you. It just kind of be dormant. Now, you can take that and use it for God, or you could go back to your old ways and begin to start going out on the street, start hustling again. You know, and some of us, when certain situations comes up upon us, certain things happen to us, we forget about who we are, and we go back to those old patterns. We go back to that old way. And it just seemed like, it almost seemed like the children of Israel. When the children of Israel came out of Egypt and they went into the wilderness, you know, they turned around and told Moses, you know, Moses, it's better for us to go back. We could go back and be slaves, because we know if we go back and be slaves, we know what we got to do over there. We know we're going to eat over there. We know things are going to happen. But we're standing out here in the wilderness and not knowing we're going to die in the wilderness. Now, you know that ain't nothing but the trick of the enemy. To try to get you to go back from where you came out of. Yes. To try to tell you that your old sinful ways is better than living for Christ. And unfortunately, some of us at certain times, and it's not every day, but at certain times, we do slip back. We do go back even for a moment. Even in our own mind, we think about it. You know, oh man, a cigarette show would be good right about now. Y'all know who I'm talking about. Y'all, because the truth is told that some of y'all used to know how to cuss. and thought you were a real good cusser and could cuss with a song on it. And folks were like, "Ooh, man, that girl can cuss." And then you got into the church. And now you talk about hallelujah, praise the Lord, thank you, Jesus, and somebody cut you off. You go right back to that old pattern. Let me, you know, and it's really funny because that's exactly what happens. You get ready to say something, you be like, and the Holy Spirit steps in and just kind of tie your tongue up just a minute. And you be like, you really want to get it out because it's right there. Oh my God. I know, I'm the only one that goes through that, I know. I know. I'm the only one to have a problem, you know, at times. But we have to learn that we're in this fight, you know, and this flesh don't give up. This flesh is gonna be fighting with us. I wrote down a quote from Billy Graham. This came out of his book. He says, referring to flesh, flesh refers to the old pattern by which we attempt to get all our needs supplied instead of seeking Christ first and trusting in him to meet our needs. What he's saying is, before we got saved, we were trying to meet our own needs. We were trying to do our own thing. Because we understand that Christ has more for us, and we're, oh my God, you know, let me tell you this way. Let me talk about me for a simple. God, I wonder what I'm talking about them. But for me, it was when I got saved and God told me to preach the gospel. I said no. I said, you have to prove it to me. You know, here I am. No, I ain't doing it. But yet, I don't want to be embarrassed either. And God embarrassed me like 3 times to get me to get up to preach the gospel. And then when he told me to open a church, I said, God, who do you want me to open a church? I said, who's going to come? He said, the homeless. He said, those who are in recovery, those who are downtrodden. He goes, I told you to go to the streets and preach the gospel. But I'm worried about who's going to come. I'm worried about who's going to pay the bills. I'm worried about how the money's going to come. And he, don't even worry about that. Just go do what I tell you to do. And then when we start doing the church, and then he tells me to leave one job and go to another job. And I said, he's funny, because I go from a job making almost $70,000 down to $30,000, then down to the church for $10,000. And all our bills are still paid. Because he said, you need to see it? He goes, I close this place up. And you know what? And I tell folks that he did something at Home Depot, that this is the only place, the only state that did it. He took away my job. Out of the whole state of Connecticut, out of all the Home Depots, this one in Connecticut, he took away my job. He took away my job because I was being hard-headed. He took away my job because I was going back to my old pattern. I was looking at my budget. I was trying to make the money. I was trying to do what I need to do. And he said, no, trust me. And we have to learn how to step out and trust him. That when we stand out to trust him, watch what he does. You know, my wife watches this dog trainer guy. But the thing is, and his training, or in anybody's training, how they train a dog is they give the dog what they like at first. You know, and Chief is good for that. We'll give Chief some meat. Chief will eat that meat all day long and just be so happy. But then one day we took the meat and put it down on the floor and told Chief to sit. Told him not to move. You know, and the dog is sitting there, he's looking at that meat, but yet he hears the voice. He hears the voice of the master. He begins to listen to what the master is telling him. He has to learn how to obey the master. And when the master says go and get, then he'll go and get it. We have to be that way. We have to learn how to listen to the voice of Jesus. And when Jesus tell us to sit and tell us to wait and tell us to listen to his voice. See, we want to go back into our old patterns. We just want to go ahead and do it ourselves. We don't want to wait on him. We know that we can do it ourselves. And you can't do it yourself. He can do it for you better. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. And because he can do it for us better, we need to learn how to just stand and wait on him. You know, I like what Paul said. Paul said in verse 15, he said, I don't understand myself at all. I don't understand myself at all. Because sometimes we think we got it made. We think we know what we're doing. We think we know how to go about it. But yet you really don't. Oh. Verse 16, he says, I know perfectly well that what I am doing is wrong. And how many times that we do things and we know that it's wrong, and yet we still continue to do it. Just like verse 17, he said, I can't help myself. I know that I'm rotten through and through so far as my old nature may be concerned. No matter which way I turn, I can't do it on my own. When you do what is right, it is evident that I'm going to do what is wrong. Oh, miserable person that I am. Paul makes seven statements describing his fight with the flesh. He makes seven things, and even as he's doing it, he's looking and he's trying to help us to overcome the issues that we're going through. And some of us don't want to overcome the issues that we're going through. Some of us love right where we are. We don't want to move right where we are. But God said, I'm making a way for you. And as I make a way for you, you need to see where you are. So as you see where you are, you can see how to correct yourself. And this is a growing thing. This is something that just doesn't happen overnight. This is something that it takes a little time for it to work out. It takes a little time to get through. See, because the truth is told, we all have some skeletons in our closet. Some of us got bodies in our closet, not only skeletons, but we have these things that we resort back to. Because as we resort back to them, they seem like they're supposed to try to help us get through the day or help us get through the night. But when you come to the realization that God is there for you and God would always be there for you, it makes no difference what it looks like on the outside. It only makes a difference what it looks like on the inside. And God has been just that good to us that he's willing to show us ourselves, that as he shows us ourselves, that we'll be able to stand on his word. And none of us in here are perfect. None of us in here have dotted every I or crossed every T. None of us have did that. But yet we find ourselves again and again falling. We find ourselves again and again falling backwards and not understanding why. And one of the reasons why is because of this flesh. Because we keep falling back into this old pattern. We keep going back to the things we think we know, the things that we think that we can get over on, the things that we, you know, I'm good for saying some of the guys that I know, when reality strikes, they're ready to run. They're ready to run. They're ready to run and hide because they can't face reality. They can't face the bills that come forward. They can't face standing up and doing what is right. They'd rather go back. And some of the women that we know that always feel comfortable when they have somebody in their bed. You know, whether they're in love with them or not, they just got to need to have a body in their bed. You know, and the guys are always, you know, when I was growing up, and good thing, thank God I got delivered, but when I was growing up, they told me it was a sorry rat that only had one hole to crawl in. That way, if one woman turned you away, you got another place to go. So I'm so glad that I walked away from that, from some of the things that I was taught growing up. Some of the guys that I was hanging around growing up, those guys, they weren't good for me at all, but I didn't know that at the time. But once you begin to know who Christ is, and you begin to understand who your flesh is, and you begin to understand that you need to put this flesh under check. Yeah. You know, and the biggest way to do that is learning how to fast. Because once you learn how to fast, you begin to get the Spirit to speak more to you, to speak more powerful to you, to be able to hold you. If you can't turn your plate over and walk away for a half a day, something's wrong. You should be able to turn your plate over and say, I'm skipping breakfast, or I'm skipping lunch, or I'm skipping dinner, and be able to be satisfied with that and learn how to pray and ask God for deliverance. See, deliverance is already yours. The victory is already yours. You already have it.
Right.
Satan has already been defeated.
Right.
We have to realize that. We have to stand in that. We have to lift him up. No matter what you're going through, you're fighting a fixed fight. It's a fixed fight. It looked like you might be knocked down today, but guess what? You win. You win. Get back up. Look and see what God is doing. You know, and as I get ready to close, and as I get ready to take my seat, you know, I like what the other translation said in verse 24. Oh, wretched man that I am. I am so down, so bad, so a slave to sin. How can I be saved? How can I get out of this? And then he goes, thank God it has been done by Jesus Christ, our Lord, who has set me free. It's Jesus Christ that steps in and set us free. It's Jesus Christ that cleanses us. It's Jesus Christ that cleanses us through his blood. It's Jesus Christ that washes us as pure as white.
Yes, yes.
He's the only one I know that can take a corrupt man and make him good. He can take a drunk man and make him sober. He can take a deceitful man and make him honest. He can take a selfish man and make him have consideration. A godless man and make him righteous. A greedy man and make him generous. A weak man and make him strong. He's the only one I know that can step in and change somebody. The only one. You can run from here to there. You can talk to whoever you want to, but it's only Jesus that's going to change that situation.
Yes, yes.
Only he's going to step in and change it. Only him. I'm going to give you one scripture and I'm going to go sit down. Ephesians chapter 4. Again, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. In Ephesians chapter 4, starting at the 17th verse. Says, let me say this, then speaking for the Lord. He's speaking for the Lord. Live no longer as unsaved do, for they are blinded and confused. Their closed hearts are full of darkness. They always are far away from the life of God, because they have shut their minds against him. And they cannot understand his ways. They don't care anymore about right or wrong, and haven't given themselves over to impure ways. They stop at nothing, being driven by the evil mind and reckless lust. But that isn't the way Christ taught you. If you have really heard his voice and learned from him and the truth concerning him, then throw out your old evil nature. The old you that was a partner is evil ways, rotten through and through, full of lust and shame. Now your attitude and thoughts must all be concerning change for the better. Yes, you must be a new and different person, holy and good. Clothe yourself with this new nature. Stop lying to each other. Tell the truth, for we are parts of one another. And when we lie to one another, we hurt ourselves. Amen? When I begin to look at that in the New Living Translation, it really kind of gave that a different flavor. It gave it a different flavor because you know, it spoke more plainly, more openly, more to us. And we have heard God's word. We've been hearing God's word. God has spoken to each and every one of us, and the change has come. And even as I stand here today, I have seen so many more people grow up in God in this church alone. You have changed. You're listening to His voice. We need you now to just focus in on it. So when that time comes that we think about going backwards, you'll hear His voice and you will stop and you begin to live as God is calling you to live. See, God has a destiny for each and every one of us. God has a place for each and every one of us. And He's trying to get us there. And the only way He can get us there is we have to be obedient to His voice. We have to be like chief sometimes. And we got to sit there until you say come, until you say go, until He says come, or until He says go. And when He says it, then we move. And when we move, we have more joy on the other side. Come on, give God a hand praise. Fighting the flesh. Fighting the flesh. This is another part to this, and I'll go into that next week. But fighting the flesh is a battle that we just can't give up on. It's one that we have to continue to look at. It's one that we have to continue to, as long as we're in this body, it's going to happen. It's going to happen. You're going to have thoughts. And when you have the thoughts, you got to have the right mind, oh my God, to be able to cast those thoughts out. You know, I mentioned last week of Magneto putting on his helmet in X-Men. That's the helmet of salvation. We need to keep all this other stuff out of our mind and just hold on to what God is telling us. And as God is telling us, walk what God is telling us, going in the direction God is showing us to go in. And watch what He does. Watch what He does when you begin to move forward. I know I mentioned to some folks before that God has big dreams for you. You don't even know it. Because you're so stuck right here. This is all you see. This is all you know. But yes, He does have a house for you. Yes, He does have a car for you. Yes, you can go on vacation. Yes, you can have some money in your pocket. Yes, you can retire and not worry about anything. Yes, God can do it for you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank
you. You have to want it. For so long, we've been stuck in just our own little world and trying to make it from paycheck to paycheck, or trying to make it from one month to the next month, trying to make our money scratch. But God said, if you do it my way, if you do it my way, there's more to your life than what you see right now. Say, well, I'm looking for a spouse. Guess what? He has a spouse for you. One that you don't even realize. It's being, oh my God. Come on, let's stand. Because that is another sermon. But what I'm trying to get you to see is you are here looking at where you are right now. You're not where God is looking at you down the road. And when you begin to understand and look at yourself from where God is looking at you, you'll find that some of the friends you have now, they're like crabs. They're just trying to hold you down. God is trying to surround you with new friends. He's trying to surround you with friends that's going to help build you up, that's going to push you forward, that's going to push you up. That as you go up, oh my God, you think people are talking about you now? You think folks are wanting to put you down now? Wait till God starts working on you. Wait till God starts elevating you. And the more God elevates you, the more those folks that you're leaving behind will get madder and madder and madder at you for no reason. For no reason. They'll start lying on you for no reason. Only because God has blessed you. And that's, And that's a shame. But guess what? I need to do what God is calling me to do. I need to go in the direction that God is leading me to go into. That as I walk the way God is telling me to walk, as I talk the way God is telling me to talk, as I go forth and do His will, He's going to turn around and bless. He's going to open the windows of heaven. He's going to pour you out blessings that you don't have room enough to receive it. You're going to be healed. You're going to be delivered. Yeah. You're going to be set free. Your household's going to be free. Everyone in your house can be saved. Everything can be looking better than what you already had. All because you're looking beyond where you are right now. You're looking beyond that. You're looking beyond that. You're looking beyond that. God already had. God has the job for you. You just don't even realize He has it for you. He has a job for you that you never even dreamed of, that you never even thought of. All you want to do is make ends meet. But God said, I got something else for you. You're looking to get a little Humpty. God's looking to get you a brand new car. You're looking to get another apartment, maybe a two-bedroom apartment. God is going to give you a four-room house.
Amen.
We just got to get out of our own way. And because we get in our own way, we get delayed. The blessings are still there, but we just get delayed. He's looking to bless you, church.
This has been another episode of This Is Your Season. To find out more about Grace and Mercy Baptist Church, please contact us by calling 860-343-7335 or writing us at Grace and Mercy Baptist Church, P.O. Box 2301, Middletown, Connecticut, 06457. We are currently located at 13 Waverly Ave in Portland, Connecticut. You can also find us on the web at gracemercyministries.com and like us on Facebook at facebook.com/Grace Mercy Church. We hope to see you soon. Thank you for enjoying our program and have a blessed day.